So the Torah describes the mitzvah of shofar in two ways. One way it describes it as Yom Trua Yelachem, it's a day of blowing of the shofar. And in Parashas Emor, it describes the shofar as a Zichron Trua, to remember the shofar. So we know there's only one mitzvah of shofar. So what exactly do we need two different psukim to tell us about the mitzvah of shofar? So we'll see. This will be a fundamental dispute between the Yerushalmi, the Jerusalem Talmud, and the Bavli. So the way the Yerushalmi learns, and this is the beginning of the fourth parak in Rosh Hashanah, the Bavli is Havamina, because the Bavli thinks to say this, but they later reject it. So we'll just call it the Yerushalmi, because the Yerushalmi keeps it. The Yerushalmi writes, it's very simple. Lo kasha, there's no contradiction. Kan b'Rosh Hashanah shachol b'chol, that when Rosh Hashanah falls out during the week, and one pasuk is talking about Rosh Hashanah falls out on Shabbos. When Rosh Hashanah falls out during the week, it's a Yom Chua. We blow the shofar, so you hear the shofar. When Rosh Hashanah falls out on Shabbos, we don't blow the shofar. It's only a Zichron Chua. Just to go back a step, the Mishnah says, B'mikdash hayu token. In the Beis HaMikdash, even on Shabbos, they used to blow shofar. That's the Mishnah in Rosh Hashanah, and everyone agrees to that. So on Shabbos, in the Beis HaMikdash, they blew shofar. What is considered the Mikdash? That's a general dispute, Rashi and the Rambam. How inclusive are we? So Rashi goes with the literal, which we'll work with. Mikdash means Mikdash, in the Beis HaMikdash. The Rambam goes with the Er HaTika, the whole old city of Yerushalayim. That's considered Mikdash. We'll just work with Rashi to keep it simple, but that's the Rambam sheet in general. That when it says Mikdash, it's referring to the old city of Yerushalayim as well, which has the Kedusha. But either way, in the Mikdash, wherever the Mikdash is, they used to blow shofar on Shabbos. Avaloma Medina, but not outside. So according to the Yerushalmi, so Yom Trua says during the week, and Zichron Trua is on Shabbos. So the question on Yerushalmi is, so if Zichron Trua tells me there's no mitzvah of shofar on Shabbos, so why did they blow shofar in the Beis HaMikdash? In fact, this is the reason, based on this kasha, the Bavli rejects this. According to the Yerushalmi, if there is no mitzvah of shofar on Shabbos, so why did they blow in the Beis HaMikdash? So that the Yerushalmi has a special drasha they learn out from the juxtaposition. It says the pasuk Yom Trua next to the Karbanos in Parashas Pinchas, I believe. So therefore, the Gemara, the Yerushalmi makes a drasha in the place of the Karbanos. It's always a Yom Trua. Special Xeris HaKas of a special drasha in the place of the Beis HaMikdash, it's always Yom. So Yerushalmi has his own drasha. So Yerushalmi says the Beis HaMikdash is different, a special drasha. But outside the Beis HaMikdash, there is no mitzvah period. It doesn't make a difference where you are. Outside the Beis HaMikdash, there is no mitzvah of shofar on Shabbos. And the Bavli disagrees and says, no, that's not the pshat. Really, both in the Beis HaMikdash, both outside the Beis HaMikdash, it's the same mitzvah to blow shofar on Shabbos. There's no difference. The chiyav is Yom Trua. That refers not only to during the week, but even when Rosh Hashanah falls out on Shabbos, it's also a Yom Trua. So if that's the case, then, so how come we blow shofar in the Beis HaMikdash, but we don't blow shofar outside of the Beis HaMikdash? So that's what the Bavli says. That's a rabbinical injunction. That biblically speaking, we should blow shofar even on Shabbos, even in Hamilton, even in New York, even in L.A. However, Gzeira de Rabba, one of the rabbis, came along to prevent Chilul Shabbos, to prevent desecration of Shabbos, which is much worse than not hearing the shofar, because as the Gemara says, everybody's obligated in the mitzvah of shofar, but not everyone is an expert in blowing the shofar. And the concern is you're going to go on Shabbos, carry the shofar without an Erev, of course, and violate Shabbos. So according to the Bavli, Minato, there is no difference between the Beis HaMikdash and the Medina. We should blow shofar everywhere. So the question is, why are we blowing shofar on Shabbos in the Beis HaMikdash? Because it's Zichron and Trua. So we have our answer because of a special connection between in the Beis HaMikdash, it's always the place. So according to the Bavli, that's not the question. The question is, why don't we blow shofar outside the Beis HaMikdash? And the answer is because Gzera Derabba. Because we're afraid you could come to carry the shofar and desecrate Shabbos. You asked me, so why don't we take Gzera Derabba in the Beis HaMikdash also? So now we have another principle, Ein Shvus B'Mikdash, which means Ein, there are no. Shvus means rabbinical prohibitions, B'Mikdash. We don't make rabbinical prohibitions in the Mikdash. Kohanim is reasoning. Kohanim are careful, and if we're not concerned, it's going to lead to Chilul Shabbos. So we have a fundamental, everyone agrees to the conclusions, but we have a fundamental difference in reason. So the bottom line is, everyone agrees to, in the Beis HaMikdash on Shabbos, when Rosh Hashanah fell out on Shabbos, they blew shofar. Outside the Beis HaMikdash, they did not blow shofar. So why did they blow shofar in the Beis HaMikdash? According to the Bavli, why not? It says Yom Chua, so you blow shofar, it's Rosh Hashanah. According to the Yishalmi, who says there is no mitzvah of shofar on Shabbos, Zichron Chua, he has to come up with a special juxtaposition between Karbanos and Yom Chua. And the Kasha is, according to the Yishalmi, there is no question why we don't blow. You know why we don't blow shofar on Shabbos in Hamilton, in Toronto, in New York? Because Zichron Chua, there's no mitzvah. And according to the Bavli, you have to come on to, no, really you should, but Gzera Derabba, rabbinical prohibition, Gzera preventing us from doing it. So the bottom line is the same. So of course the next question is, my nafkamina, what is the practical difference? Who cares? What's the difference? If the bottom line is, I blow in the Beis HaMikdash, I don't blow outside the Beis HaMikdash, why are we getting so worked up over the reasons behind the Yishalmi and the Bavli? Okay, maybe not getting worked up. Maybe you should be. So, my nafkamina, what's the practical difference? So, we'll give a couple of practical differences because we live in a bottom line society and we need, what have you done for me lately? You're as good as your last at bat, and therefore you need some bottom line answers. That's what I'm here for. So, first practical difference is a very practical one. During the week, how many blessings are there in the Shmoneh Esrei? The Shmoneh Esrei is a very trick question because there are really 19 blessings. One was added later on. But the classical Shmoneh Esrei, you can count them later, there are 19. What about on Shabbos? How many?
Hello?
Nine?
There are seven. Shabbos and Yom Tov. See, the first three and last three don't change every day of the year. And then during the week, so let's go back. I said the three sections to the Shmoneh Esrei. The first section is the Shevach, is the praise. Those are the first three, are always the same. And the end of Shmoneh Esrei is the Hodah, is the thank you. Those are any Shmoneh Esrei the whole year, we have it. So you have to redo it or continue?
I think you have to redo it.
It shouldn't be. Should we find out if done or not? Or done, we'll do it.
Alright, I've never used that.
Okay, either way. Worst case, we'll have two of them. Mm-hmm. So we have three sections to Shmoneh Esrei. The Shevach, praise. Bakasha, the request. And then the thank you. So during Shabbos and Yom Tov, We don't make requests or physical things usually. So we only have seven. We mention Kedusha Sayom on Shabbos and Yom Tov. So in fact, there's a discussion on Rosh Hashanah, how many we have on the Musaf Rosh Hashanah, because we have three things: we have Zichronos, Malchus, and Shofaros. So there's a discussion whether you make them into all one or three, so we have the Musaf in Rosh Hashanah. That's the longest Shmoneh Esrei of the year, in terms of So for some people, instead of taking 30 seconds, it might take 45. For others, instead of 5 minutes, it might take 25 minutes. So whatever you could play in the number, whatever it applies. So let's say you're davening Musaf Rosh Hashanah, and even though we reject the Yerushalmi, but we do accept it partially, because if you look at your Magzor on Rosh Hashanah, it says, when Rosh Hashanah falls out during the week, insert the words Yom Chua. And when Rosh Hashanah falls out on Shabbos, insert the words Zichron Chua. That's what we do. So what happens, it's either, let's say this year, so it's during the week. So let's say instead of saying Yom Chua, you insert the word Zichron Chua. So if you remember right away, no big deal. You finish davening, and then after you finish the 25 minutes Shmoneh Esrei, you realize, oh, I said Zichron Chua instead of Yom Chua. Do I have to repeat Shmoneh Esrei? So it depends. According to Yerushalmi, yeah, you're davening the wrong Shmoneh Esrei, because according to Yerushalmi, Zichron Chua relates to Shabbos, Yom Chua relates during the week. We know that luck is you change the Nusach HaTfilah, so you have to daven over again. However, according to the Bavli, even though it's true Lechatchila, those Yom Chua relates more to during the week, but they really both apply equally to both days. So therefore, we paskin, you're in luck, you don't have to repeat Shmoneh Esrei. That's one very practical difference to Yerushalmi versus Bavli. If I switch the word Zichron Chua and Yom Chua, so you should still strive for the right words, but b'di'evit, if you mess up, so less pressure on you, you'll be able to have more kavana now during Musaf. Another practical difference, this is more practical for Sfardim than it is Ashkenaz, as you'll see in a second why. But there's a halakha of Shechiyanu. We make a Shechiyanu on Shofar. As a general rule, we make on any mitzvah we do, which is She'eino Tadir, which is not continuous, and it comes Mizman Lizman. You know, so on matzah we make all the mitzvahs that come during seasonal, like Baskin Robbins has seasonal flavors and classics. So too, we have classics and we have seasonal. So seasonal is you make the Shechiyanu on, because it's new and you have the freshness, it's a type of simcha. So we make a Shechiyanu on Shofar. It's Rosh Hashanah is 2 days, even in Israel. You get a rare 3-day Yantif in Israel. At least they only have Rosh Hashanah. The other two they won't. But even Israel gets the 3-day, 2 days Rosh Hashanah going into Shabbos this year. So you make a Shechiyanu. Do we make one Shechiyanu? Is that enough? Do we make two Shechiyanus? How many Shechiyanus do we make on Rosh Hashanah for the Shofar? It's actually a similar, whether it's the same issue or not, to another question, but we have the same machlokas, Svarim Ashkenaz, by Megillah on Purim. We only read the Megillah. Purim's only 1 day, that's true, but we read the Megillah twice. So whether you say two Shechiyanu, so the minhag Svard, again, among Svardim, you always have different minhagim, because every time I say minhag Svard, I have some Svardi come over to me and tell me they have a different minhag. So now I just cover myself. But the classic minhag Svard is to only make one bracha. They make a bracha also only on the night of the Purim, and also, but to our purposes here, they only make a Shechiyanu the first day, it goes on both days. Ashkenaz, we make both days, so that's the fact. Now I'll give you the nafkamina. So this wasn't even a hypothetical. This happened, I don't know, about 150 years ago or so in Yerushalayim, Ir HaKodesh. A big Talmud Chacham, I forget his name, you know, the Mikrai Kodesh of Rav Pesach Frank brings it down in the Sefer. It gets into how you learn the Gemara we were discussing in the B'miktosh HaYutokin, in the Beis HaMikdosh, they used to blow shofar even on Shabbos. Number one, we said, according to the Rambam, the Mikdash means the old city. So either maybe he was working with the Rambam's opinion, he felt on Shabbos, he was in Yerushalayim, in the old city, he felt you have to blow shofar. Or it depends how you learn the Gemara there, because when they moved to Yavne, the Beis HaGadol met in the Lishkas HaGazes in the Beis HaMikdash, but then after it dispersed, so they moved to Yavne. So it's a question over there, was it a din and based in, a din? So there's a rift opinion that we don't paskin like, but there's some who do, obviously, that according to the riff, if you have in front of a makam based in, even on Shabbos, so whatever his rationale was, he had a lachak basis, not the accepted opinion, but he had basis for it. And he went ahead, and he, everyone knew in this shul they were going to blow shofar on Shabbos. So the shaila they asked, or Svi Petzach Frank and others, or maybe he's just relaying, I don't know if he was around at that time or not, but he writes about it, is, should I try to go to shul in for Shabbos? Should we try to go to, because in my shul they're not going to be blowing shofar. So should I try to go and hear the shofar in this? Because there's no problem in hearing the shofar. The problem would be blowing the shofar. I'm not doing any. If I get a mitzvah, I get a mitzvah. If not, I got nothing. So there's no harm. Should I try to go? Is there any gain by me? There's certainly no harm, but is there any gain by me going ahead and I'm listening? So that was the question. So this person did it, and that was the question. So what is the issue dependent on? Before I get into what happened, what is the issue dependent on? So this touches on a fundamental issue, because we just pointed out, we said that why don't we blow shofar on Shabbos outside the Beis HaMikdash? So what did we say? Why don't we blow shofar? Biblically we should. Why don't we? Because the rabbi said not to. So let me ask you something. God tells me to do something, the rabbis tell me not to, who do I listen to? I listen to God, or I guess it depends which rabbis also, but who do I listen to? So I always had to listen to God, but the problem is God told me to listen to the rabbis. That's the pasuk in Parsha, or maybe it's not a problem, it's the reality. In Parsha Shoftim, it says, the pasuk goes, Sasa min adavar ashe yagidu cha yaminu smo. It says, don't turn away from the rabbis. The context is the Zakein Mamre. See, there is an advantage of not knowing anything. I'll explain what I mean in a second. There's a concept of a Zakein Mamre, Zakein Elder, Mamre, rebellious. In Hilchas Ma. So the case is, someone who paskins against the Beis Din HaGadol, he's put to death. There's an interesting Ramban on it, that these are a couple of examples in the Torah where you're not actually punished for an onus you did. Normally in Judaism you're punished for something you did, an act you did. There are a couple of exceptions where it's not the act, but it's hitting the fundamentals. So if you're going to break up the whole, if you're going to undermine the whole Beis Din HaGadol, so that's, or Ben Sora Mora is another, it's a couple of examples the Ramban gives, a separate shir. Or maybe it's already on kosher too, somewhere, I don't remember. But either way, so they point out that Zakein Mamre is put to death for rebelling against. So who is it? So who is the Zakein? So if someone, so, you know, we live in a society of talk radio. So what I mean is talk radio, you know, you call in, well, the talker says, you know, and which by most times talk, the host usually doesn't know any more than you, but you talk and he says his opinion, you call in, and everyone goes and gives their opinion. So everyone's entitled to give an opinion, but not all opinions are equal. In other words, like, everyone understands that when it comes to, let's say, Shakespeare or Hamlet or something, you know, if you don't have a PhD, like, are you kidding me? Like, they'll laugh at you when you say, but when it comes to the Bible, you know, everyone thinks they know it better than everyone else. Everyone, it's okay to have an opinion, but realize not all opinions are equal. So obviously someone who studied the, you know, the Gemara Chumash for 25 years versus someone who just, like, during Kriyas HaTorah looked over the Pasuk for about 10 seconds and they think they know what it means better than someone else. So, but the point being here, making is, if someone just gets up and says, basically, they don't know what they're talking about, and this guy's an Amaret, he doesn't know anything. He's not put to death. They just laugh at him and they move on. But if someone's a big Talmud Chacham and he's Higia Lahora and he passed, then they put him to death. So you have to earn an opinion, you know, in terms of that sense. You don't just, you know, of course everyone has a right, you should ask questions, you have opinions, you have to know, you know, not all the opinions are equal. So either way, so what happened was, is, so it says, "Losasam and Adavar Shayyid Yirchal Yemenu Smol." So I don't know if you ever anyone read the book, The Cain Mutiny. It's a classic, not a seasonal. No one read it. Okay, haven't either, by the way. But the Cain Mutiny was written by who? I was thinking to myself who wrote it. But if you didn't read it, you probably don't know who wrote it. But I'm thinking of his name. I can't think of it now. But he, what happened was he taught at Yeshiva University for a short time period. So he was explaining, let me tell you what the Cain Mutiny is about. Again, I didn't read it either. What it's about is Cain is apparently the name of the ship. Mutiny is what happened on the ship. And basically chaos broke up on the ship. I think the captain was whacked out and he was giving orders. I guess the issues were, but the captain has complete control. I guess like a pilot on a plane. So do I listen to a wacko captain or not, I guess was the issue. So he wrote the Cain Mutiny. So he said, you know where he got it from? He got it from Rashi and Chumash, he claims. What does it mean, Rashi and Chumash? Because this pasuk. The pasuk says, don't turn away from the rabbi's right. What does that mean, right or left? So Rashi quotes the Sifri, even if the rabbis tell you left is right and right is left, you have to listen. And certainly if they tell you left is left and right is right. But even if they left, so Rashi quotes the Sifri. So he says, look, they're like the wacko captain. Even if they're wrong, you got to listen to them. That's how he interpreted Rashi there, the Sifri. And that's why. So one of the students said to him, I don't want to insult you, or you might have to change the name of your book, but that's really not the pshat in Rashi. You clearly haven't learned the Ramban, who asked that kasha in Rashi, and it's a Mishnah in Hari. It's clear that if Beis Din made a mistake, we don't follow mistakes. We don't go, there's no precedent on mistakes. If you make a mistake, and that's why it talks about the Beis Din, if you make a mistake, you got to bring a karban, the Kohen Gadol, the basin. So that's true. If you make a mistake, you correct the mistake. We don't go mistake just because someone says it. And what the Sifri is saying is if it appears to you like it's a mistake, like you don't know anything, if you think the rabbis, I mean, then you should follow them. But if you're a Talmud Chacham and you see they made a mistake, again, not if it's a base in a gadol, that's a different issue. When you can tell them, not as Petorah's psak, but to tell them, but today is not an issue. We don't have base in a gadol, so then obviously you wouldn't follow it. So that's the Ramban writes. That's not the pshat. So that's not the pshat in Rashi. So he never changed the name of his book, by the way. But either way, so Rav Chanan Wasserman says as follows. This is the pshat. We know we have a Gemara. We have a Gemara in Yevamos which says, Yesh koach b'yad chachamim la'akord v'ar Torah b'shevi al-tasa. There's power among, how much power do these rabbis have? So one of the limitations is they only can tell you not to do something. They can tell you not to perform the mitzvah today, not to blow shofar, not to shake lulav. But if you're having a Mac attack, they can't tell you to go to McDonald's and have a Big Mac. They don't have to. That's actively violating what the Torah is saying. They can't tell you to do that. So he says like this. That's what the pasuk means. What does the Sifri mean when they're telling you left is right and right is left? This is it. The Torah says blow shofar today, yom trua. The rabbis say no shofar. So there's right telling you left is, and who do we listen to? That's what the pasuk's telling me. Well, sasam and adavar, we follow the rabbis. So the rabbis, again, even within that power, they have limited power. But that's what Rabbi Chanan says, that's what the pasuk is referring to. And in fact, that's the question. How much power do the Chachamim have when they say they can uproot a mitzvah? So what does that mean? So let's take shofar on Shabbos. So the rabbis, so biblically speaking, there's a mitzvah to blow shofar on Shabbos. The rabbis say no. So what does that mean? Does that mean the mitzvah of shofar no longer exists at all? Do they have that much power? No, they don't have that much power. They tell me, I don't have a mitzvah anymore, but the mitzvah of shofar still exists. They can't. They don't. That's a discussion among the Rishonim and the different examples. How far does it go? Let's say by the first Mishnah in Brachas, there's an example Rabbi Yonah gives that the rabbi. The really you could say Shema, which by the way you have to repeat later, Kriya Shema, because Shkia was about 7:55 today, so you could have a Ma'ariv after sunset. You wait too later to say Shema. So So the Mishnah says you could say Shema until dawn, Alos HaShachar. But the Chachamim said you should say it until, by midnight, in order to so you don't forget and miss it. So Rabbi Yonah discusses over there in the first stop in Brachas, now that the rabbi said you should do it at Chatzos, so he discusses, does that mean now that's it? Someone who does it after, clear if you do it after Chatzos, you violated the rabbinical prohibition. But does that mean the person doesn't get the mitzvah at all anymore? To come once they uprooted the mitzvah completely? No. They still get the mitzvah, but they didn't do it precisely. There's many examples. So that's the question here. When the rabbi said no shofar, what did they do? So that's what Rabbi Akiva Eger raises, and that's the question here. So this rabbi who is blowing shofar on Shabbat. So according to the Yerushalmi, there's nothing to talk about. There's no mitzvah. Zichron Trua, it's like blowing shofar this Shabbos. It's a meaningless activity. Don't try to go to the shul and listen to it. It's a waste of time. Zichron Trua, according to Yerushalmi, there is no mitzvah. But according to the Bavli, who says really there is a mitzvah, and the rabbi said not to, so that depends on this machlokas rishonim and achronim. When the rabbi say no shofar, does it mean the mitzvah shofar no longer exists, which would be a big chiddush? Or do we say probably more pashtus that they can't uproot the mitzvah, they could just tell me not to do it? The Sikh President Frank wants to say it depends, which is a separate, yet maybe different mitzvahs. Some were uprooted completely, some weren't, as the Minchas Chinuch talks about. Sometimes the mitzvah drabbanan is supplementing the mitzvah minatar, like making kiddush over wine. Biblically, it's with words, and other times, sometimes it's coming to supplement, other times it's coming, so we have to analyze each mitzvah. But that's the question here. So that would be a nafka min. According to Yerushalmi, don't waste your time. Unless, of course, you learn it's in the mikdash, and then the Yerushalmi would. But here we're talking about, you know, if you did it in Yerushalayim, then you could talk about it. But according to the Bavli, it would depend on this issue or not. So getting back, so practically speaking, it's not Shabbos this year, or Hamilton, it wouldn't work. But the question is like this: let's say what happens. It's Rosh Hashanah on Shabbos first day, and you forget. Let's say the shul, they forget it Shabbos, or they forget that you don't blow shofar on Shabbos. And they went ahead and they made a shachiyah and they blew 100 blasts. Well, they remember after 30, whatever the case is, let's assume 100, they got the whole works in. And then someone comes after, it's Shabbos today. Oh yeah, we shouldn't have blown shofar. Okay, it's over, what are you going to do now? So for us Ashkenazim, it will make a difference. We're going to make a shachiyah tomorrow anyway. The shaila is, according to the Sfardim, would they make a second would they make another Shechianu on that Sunday? So according to the Yerushalmi, you know, if you assume there's no mitzvah at all, then they didn't do anything, so therefore they have to make a new Shechianu. But according to the Bavli, it would depend on this question on whether the rabbis could uproot the mitzvah completely, or then we could tell you personally not to do it, but the mitzvah exists. So those are a couple of nafkaminas. One is if you miss up Zichron Trua and Yom Trua, whether someone blows shofar on Shabbos, is there any kiyum should I try to get to listen to it? And thirdly, if you're among Sfardim, should you make another Shechiyano? So what we'll have to answer still is, according to the Bavli, we'll have to, we continue this another time. Rav Salveji got a 6-hour shear on what I'm about to say. So we might have to continue this another time. Maybe I could do it in a little less time. I could try to get it down to 5, I think. 5 minutes, that is. No. So it goes like this. So let's summarize and then we'll continue next time. But basically, the machlok is Yerushalmi and Bavli, everyone agrees to the facts. In the Beis HaMikdash on Shabbos, they blow shofar. Outside the Beis HaMikdash, no shofar. Why not? So according to the Yerushalmi, there's no mitzvah, Zichron Trua, on Shabbos. The two psukim, one Yom Trua is during the week, Zichron Trua is for Shabbos. So if there's no mitzvah on Shabbos, why blow in the Beis HaMikdash? A special drasha in the place of the Beis HaMikdash, in the Karbanos, it's always Yom Trua. According to the Bavli, we should always blow shofar anywhere, even here. Why don't we? Because the rabbi said not to, based on will source him in Adava, Asher Yagidu Lecha, and the whole discussion with the power of the Chachamim. So why don't we then blow shofar, why don't we say Gzeira Derab in the Beis HaMikdash? So then we don't make rabbinical injunctions in the Beis HaMikdash. So we said, bottom line, if everything is the same, so my nafkamina. So we said, the nafkamina is whether you mistake Yom Truah, Zichron Truah, could they uproot the mitzvah completely, and Svarim Mashiach Yana. What we'll have to continue next time is, which the Bavli doesn't answer, Bishlom according to Yerushalmi, I understand why I have two psukim. Yom Truah is during the week, Zichron Truah is on Shabbos. But according to the Bavli, and the Bavli doesn't answer it, why do we need two psukim? Why do we need Yom Truah and Zichron Truah according to the Bavli? So that's what we'll have to answer next time. A whole separate share on the two, as well as the Rav has a long discussion on it. That is what he's going to explain. It's going to be referring to the two different aspects of the mitzvah shofar. Not the two different days, but it's going to be two aspects of shofar, a Yom Truah and Zichron Truah, and we'll continue on that.